Good morning.
Good morning.
It's great to see you this morning on this absolutely beautiful fall morning. And I can't think of any better place to be than First Baptist Church Smackover. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right. Hey, if you're we welcome you, especially if you're visiting with us. If you'll fill out a visitor's card, they're in the pew in front of you. If you'd fill that out and drop it in the offering plate so we'd have a record of your attendance, we'd appreciate that. If y'all are ready to worship, let's stand and sing hymn number 96, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Let's sing Victory in Jesus.
Precious.
Well, good morning. Before we continue, we do have a few announcements to go through. But before we do that, I have a special prayer request. One of my best friends, Devin Hopper, who's the son of Brandy Kane. I'm sure some of y'all have been familiar with Amelia Hopper and her story over the past 2 years. Since yesterday, she's pretty much fighting for her life. She's been through a lot, and she's a tough little girl. But I just ask that today that we just say a special prayer for them. They're a strong family, and we know that the Lord gives us strength. But I just pray that today that we can just lift them up and continue to pray for their fight. Tomorrow, we actually will have the senior adult fish fry. It'll be tomorrow, November 1st at noon. Just in case I don't forget, we can put them up there too. We also have next Sunday, last Sunday I forgot to tell y'all a date, but this Sunday, November 7th, we'll be having our time change, the pancake breakfast. It'll be starting at 8, we said 8:30? 8:30 to come in, so I hope to see y'all there. I'm always confused if it's we get more time or less time. Is it we get more sleep? More sleep, then we all should be good and rested for that. So everybody come in and join us at 8:30.
Old time or new time?
That's always hard too. Maybe your clocks will adjust. If not, we'll see you when we see you. But like I said, 8:30 for our pancakes. Maybe we'll set some aside just in case you're a little early or a little late. There also is a couple more shoot boxes up here. If you have any, please remember to bring them up here by November 14th and to include the $9 shipping fee for your shoe boxes. Also, the Abide Spring Tour for Women of Joy. The deadline to sign up will be November 14th, and it's the deposit of $50. And then for the past couple of days, I've been telling myself, don't forget, don't forget, don't forget. But Miss Tina has an announcement. You told me you were going to come up here. If you forgot, then I'm going to put you on the spot. Oh, Cindy Berry, I'm going to put you on the spot too. I didn't forget.
I'll try to do this. Thank you for... Anyway. Okay. Come here. You look in your bulletin this morning. There's an insert about the heart-to-heart ministry, and I need to make a correction of what it said. It was just miscommunication. Heart-to-heart ministries is a ministry that the Lord put in Tina's heart several years ago, and it was to meet the needs of our more mature adult members, their interests, their concerns, and she and I were together in it. She gave me the privilege, asked me to help her, and then COVID hit. Well, today we have a new beginning, a new start, and it is for not only our more mature members, but it is for anyone, this is the correction, for anyone within our church here at First Baptist. We hope to bring it forward, if God will bless it, to move it into the community. But at right now, we have to have servants of the Lord to help us to be able to go community-wide. He has blessed the ministry in providing 34 other people within the body of Christ here who are willing to help. There is an electrician and a carpenter that can do minor repairs for you if you need it. Also, whatever your need may be, whether it's cooking, cleaning, you need a meal, you just need a visit, someone to talk to, phone call, transportation to and from any medical facility. If you want to go shopping or if you want to get out of the house and want to have an adventure, whatever your need may be, We would like to help you. We would like to say that, you know, we know that our older members in the church, that you're independent, you're more than capable of caring for yourself. But what we would like to do is ask you to give us the privilege to serve the Lord Jesus in helping you and any other family within the church if you need help. Because you see, we have seen in our lifetime that your faith and your endurance in serving the Lord. And so we would just ask you just to please call us, and you can call the church office or call Tina or I, and we will do all that we can to help you. And if there's anyone that would like to join us, we would be more than happy to have them. But I can tell each of you something that you can do for us. Will you go to the Lord in prayer for us as we serve, as all of the whole, well, there'll be 36 of us that will be serving the church. And that if it would please him that we do go community-wide. Thank you so much.
And the last announcement that we do have a shopping list for the Feel the Love for the Arkansas Children's Hospital Christmas Drive. We have a list for the infants and toddlers and also for the older kids and teens. Any more announcements? Oh, fifth quarter. I almost forgot my own announcement. This Friday, we'll be having a fifth quarter. For those of you who don't know what a fifth quarter is, we'll be hosting an event, I guess you could say an after party, after the football game following senior night. So if you want to help, you can contact me, or if you just want to donate snacks or anything like that, they'd be greatly appreciated. But I'm really excited to be able to start doing things for the youth, for the kids around here. So that'll be following directly after the game. We really don't have a exact time when it'll start, but we'll say 12 o'clock, midnight, when we'll stop. So anything else?
Just going to add, hey guys, we will be in school this week trying to encourage kids to be there. But remember how I told you it's not about gathering, it's about connecting? This is a gathering, and what we do is the connecting. If you know a student this week, it's your chance to go and encourage them and invite them to the park. Even if you can't invite them to church,
we'll do any, like, I guess 7th grade all the way to senior high. If you want to come and play, we can. Hey, it's a party for everybody, so.
You're too old, Tim.
He heard you that time. Anything else? Like I said, I'm really excited to be able to start doing things with the kids and get this church involved with the school and with the youth again, so. It's going to be a real blessing for me and for this church. So, alrighty, that's all I got.
Amen. Thank you, Cooper. Let's stand as we sing our offertory hymn. It's hymn number 522, Higher Ground, as our ushers come forward, please.
Stable land.
So I hope that you'll really listen to the words of the song, sing it with us, and really think about the ways that God has even shown out in your life.
Sing with us.
Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest water and deepest pain, I wouldn't trade it for anything. Cause my brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story you'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars, cause without them I wouldn't know your heart, and I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. Now I'm standing in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness, and I'm not who I was before. I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. I'm thankful for your scars, cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And with my life I'll tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful. I'm thankful for the stars, cause without them I wouldn't know your heart, and I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever
amen. Oh, it has been a good week. Anybody had a good week? Wow. Anybody have a bad week? All right. So you're just not being very, you didn't have much of a week. It was uneventful. For me, it wasn't uneventful. I had a really good week. I really enjoyed Friday night down on the street. That was great. Blocking off the street. There was people everywhere. There were some things I didn't like. You know what I mean? Like some things were, I'm looking at a kid and I'm thinking, wow, your mama bought that for you? First of all, I do, I know she doesn't like to be pointed. Miss Ruth, thank you so much for what you did. Thank you. It really was a great impact. She had all the games laid out. We got there, and it was, when we came in, people were just there, and you're handing out candy and spinning pumpkin heads and making jokes and laughing and meeting people, and it was absolutely wonderful. So many connections, good connections that were made. If you came out and volunteered, thank you so much. I'll be honest with you, I'm not a big Halloween fan. I don't celebrate death all that much. It just kind of seems like scary's the thing. I like the costumes that are like celebrating, like I like heroes. There was a guy that came up dressed as Captain America. And I mean, he had the muscles like drawn on the outfit. It was great. I loved it. I mean, I like that. I like the heroes. I like it when people dress up and like try to look like celebrities. Those are always kind of fun. And everybody has their favorite celebrities, right? Like how many people in here know Taylor Swift? Anybody know Taylor Swift? You know Taylor Swift? Goodness gracious, Jeff, why don't you tell me? Jeff knows Taylor Swift. Knows Taylor. I am a big fan. Could you introduce me? Dude, could you? Oh my goodness, if you could introduce me to Taylor Swift, I'd bring my guitar. She could like sign it. And we'd have to bring Lily. You need to introduce Lily too, because if I introduce Lily, I won't look like such a creep. But I am a huge fan of Taylor Swift. I would.
I'm sorry. I don't know her personally. I just thought you meant, do you know her? I mean, I know Taylor Swift, but not personally.
I'm not going to meet her, am I?
I don't think so. Or not because of me.
All right. It's all right, man.
It's okay. It'll be all right. Just shake it off.
Just shake it off. Okay, so I have a little bit of a confession. I'm not a like total super fan of Taylor Swift, although I'm telling you, I can rock a mean karaoke version of Shake It Off. All right? I can rock it. I'm sure I can. Now, I'm not that big of a fan, but if y'all have been around people that were like super fans, and it's not just celebrities like that. I know guys that can tell you every stat on a professional football player. They know more statistics about the guy than the guy that actually like earned them. Like, they know more about Breeze than Breeze knows about Breeze. I mean, it's just, he doesn't memorize those kind of things. People can get totally fanatical. I mean, like, you ever seen a girl freak out over a boy band? Okay, anybody want to volunteer? Yes, you were one of those little girls that freaked out over boy bands. Okay, very few. Some of y'all are lying. All right, I'll tell you what, I'm going to test it right here. Oh, 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 oh. See, I told you they were out there. I mean, there were girls that had more pictures of these guys up on their walls than like their mom had, right? And if you ever see like those girls, all of a sudden they meet their celebrity crush and they just pass out. Like they just freak out. It's like nothing says, I love you, I want to get to know you, than laying in a puddle of drool, right? I mean, it's, you could totally overdo it. They don't even know them. They kind of think they do. Now, with today's social media, we can know a lot about somebody, right? I mean, you can know their birthday, their favorite color, their mom's dog's name, what they ate for dinner last night. You can know a lot about someone, but you don't know them. See, there's a very big difference between being able to recognize someone and know them. Turn with me in your Bible this morning. We're going back to John chapter 1. I'm going to be wrapping up my sermon on the prologue of John. You're like, wow, he is taking forever. We ain't even gotten through chapter 1 yet. I'm going to go ahead and tell you we're not going all the way through the book of John. I'm really just going to preach through this this prologue. It's a poem at the beginning of the book. And what I love about it is it actually lays out the major and minor themes of the entire book right here in this one poem. So as you get there, and I hope you have a copy of your Bible with you this morning, turning to the book of John, chapter 1. While you're turning there, I'm going to read Isaiah 55:1. It says this, my word that comes from my mouth. We've been talking a lot about the word, right? Because that first verse, y'all see if y'all can say it with me. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. My word that comes from my mouth will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish what I please and will prosper in what I send it to do. What a wonderful promise from God. So as we dig into the Word this morning, let's hear it. John chapter 1, I'm going to start reading in verse 10. I'm going to read 10, 11, and 12. He, that's the Word, Jesus, He was in the world, and the world was created through Him, yet the world did not recognize Him. He came into His own, and His own people did not receive Him. But to all who did receive Him, He gave them the right to be children of God, to those who believe in His name. So as I said before, the prologue is going to give you the major and minor themes of the book of John. The major theme of the book of John is the gospel of Jesus Christ, the saving power of Jesus' sacrifice for us. Now, the first week, we talked about the fact that Jesus was there in the beginning, the eternal nature of Jesus, that He's more than just a man that lived at a time. He's a man that lived all time. All right? He lives in what we call the eternal now. There is all of time is in Him all at once. Last week, we talked about the responsibility of us to not be the light, but to reflect the light, that we are actually witnesses of who Jesus is. And this next thing is going to kind of throw a major theme of all of the New Testament, but a minor theme in the book of John, and that is the rejection of Jesus Christ and the receiving of Him. So this first verse here says, He was in the world, and the world was created through Him, yet the world did not recognize Him. Now I'm going to capitalize a little bit. The first point this morning is on that word, recognize. Say recognize. Say recognize. Say yinosko. Yeah, that was a little harder. Yinosko. All right, I would spell it out for you, but it's all Greek to me. That is actually the Greek word for the word that is translated here, recognize. But it's not always translated recognize. Some of y'all have a different word in there. It says the world did not what? Know, that knew Him not. In the King James, it says that He came into the world and the world knew Him not. This word know, yinosko, which comes out as recognize and know, is more than just to recognize someone. But it's not really the same as the way we just use the word know. There's an intimacy to that word. It is actually the same Greek word that is used when it talks about and Adam knew his wife Eve, or Joseph waited to know Mary until after the baby was born. Okay, so there's an intimacy of it. And what this word means is that not only can I recognize them, but I have a knowledge of them that is heart knowledge. I have an intimate knowledge of them. And what it's saying here is that Jesus Christ, the Creator of all things, the very Word of God made flesh in man, the one that spoke, let there be light and let there be waves and let there be beautiful things in the air, that this Creator that speaks stars into existence came to the world in flesh, and the world just did not know Him. They didn't recognize Him for who He was. Now, I'm not saying that He was not recognizable. He was recognizable. People could recognize Jesus. We know that John the Baptist, the great witness of Jesus Christ, recognized Jesus from the womb. I mean, he knew it was Him, and he couldn't even see. We know that Simeon, the great priest that was promised by God that he would see the Christ before he died, when Jesus came in as an infant into the temple, he knew Him just from seeing Him, and he went and said, "This, I can now die and peace, having seen the Messiah." When Jesus asked all the disciples, said, who do you say I am? And Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." He was recognizable. But so much of the world didn't recognize Him. Folks, I'm going to tell you that every human, every person, every people group, every religion, in some shape, form, or fashion, has to somehow deal with this question of what are you going to do about Jesus? When you know, when you hear about Him, when the words hit your ear and you find out about this person of Jesus, that you've got to somehow respond to it. If you look at the, Mormons see Jesus Christ, they say, well, He is a God. He's one of the gods, and if you're really good at doing what He says, you can actually be one too. If you ask the Muslims, you say, well, who is this person, Jesus? They say, well, He was a great prophet. Now, he wasn't the greatest prophet, but he was a great prophet. You ask the Hindus, they'll say, well, he was a great teacher. If you ask C.S. Lewis, who's dead, but you can go back and read what he said, if you want to look at Jesus, you've got what is now called the trilemma. He says he's either A, he is a liar, he is a lunatic, or he is Lord. He's got to be one of them. And we're talking about a man that says, I'm God. He says that I, and not only I am God, but I created all things. And I'm going to pay the price for each and every one of you for your sin. I can do that. You can do that to me. I'm the only way to heaven. You can come through me. Either that man is a liar, and if he's a liar, he's not a good teacher or a prophet. Right? He's not speaking the truth. Prophet means one who professes the truth. So he's not a priest, he's not a prophet, he's lying. Either that or he believes he's telling the truth, and he's not. That makes him a lunatic. Totally crazy. But if he's crazy, why did the world, the actual creation itself, obey him? You ever seen a lunatic go around and everybody say, this guy's the greatest, and the world itself starts pushing him forward? So if he's not a liar and he's not a lunatic, the only thing that's left is that he is who he says he is. The power in recognizing Jesus Christ for who he is changes everything. It changes everything. Let's keep reading. Oh, sometimes I just get to preaching. I'm sorry. Oh, it just gets on you. In verse 11, it says, as he came into his own, and his own people did not receive him. The word receive there is the next word that we're going to look at. It's paralambano. That one kind of sounds Italian. But what it means is, it actually means to grasp and take with you. The best understanding I can get of this verse is actually a wide receiver. You throw the ball, they're going along their way, and they receive it, and they take it with them. That is what it means. It means that God says, I am the Son of God, and you can not only know me, you can receive me. I can come into your heart, into your life. You can take me intimately, personally, on yourself, in your life, and you can take me with you when you go. You never drop it again. You see, when salvation comes on you, you can mess up, but you didn't drop it. He's still there. You take it. You receive it. The creator of all the world came, and the world just didn't recognize him. They didn't know him. They saw him. They saw his power. They saw his miracles. But they didn't receive him. The very people, this was, he came unto his own. When he meant his own here, he's talking about he came to Israel. This is the people that were promised through God, through Abraham, through David, these great promises that we talk about all the way through the Old Testament and even today, of the promises of God to Abraham and David, that through their line, through their lineage, that the whole world would be blessed, that their whole world would be saved. And this promise that they were looking at, that they had lots of things that were prophesied about them. They had a whole list of prophecies of what to be looking for. They knew what to look for. They were teaching each other what to look for. They made their children memorize in Sunday school. It wasn't called Sunday school then. But they made them memorize the prophecy so that when they saw the Messiah, they would know. And here he is, and he shows up. And John the Baptist says, that's him. And they didn't recognize him. And they wouldn't receive him. Isn't that the story of us today? What do we call the place we live? We're in the Bible Belt. I'm pretty sure that if you follow the buckle of the Bible Belt, it overlaps North Louisiana and South Arkansas. Right? Y'all know how many churches are in this one county? It's hundreds. Hundreds. I looked online this morning just to see. I know it's higher than that, but registered on one website, there was 287 churches. in one county. That's a lot of people saying they're Christian. So many people that recognize his face, they recognize his story. They may even recognize what he's done in other people's lives and see the power. If they never take him on as Lord, liar, lunatic, or Lord of all. That's the story. That's the essence of John 1. He's real. He's always been real. You've heard people tell you he was real, witness to you that he is real, and you can look at the reality of him in your own life, but the reality says you must receive him. Here's the thing is, I would tell you that receiving him is an absolutely amazing thing. If you don't already know, I'm seeing the Neds, yes. If you can't say amen, just nod as loudly as you can, okay? When you receive him, you're receiving some amazing stuff. If you look farther down in that, it says this. It said, but all who did receive him, he gave them the right to be children of God, to those who believe in his name. For those that received him, those that did receive him, he gave them the right to be children of God. Sons of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I don't know about y'all, but it's kind of nice being a child of the one that owns it all. I mean, when you walk into a store and dad owns it and you take a piece of gum off of the counter, it's not stealing. It's just borrowing from daddy. Right? I mean, to say that my God is a cattle on a thousand hills, I can walk a little more confidently. He can put one in my pasture when he needs to. But even better than that, even better than the fact of knowing that I can be labeled, I can be called and known forever and ever as a prince, as a child of the King. It says now just a little bit farther, it says, we have received, it's in verse 16 and 17, it says, we have all received grace after grace from his fullness, from his weightiness. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth was given through Jesus Christ. You know what that actually means? It means this. It says, look, you can live under the law, and the law says this. You obey, you get blessed. You disobey, you lose the blessing. But grace says this, I will give you unmerited favor. I will choose you even when you mess up. You can break the law, and I'm still going to love you. And yes, there's a penalty for that sin. Yes, there are consequences for that sin. You're going to live under the consequences. He's going to live under the penalty. To receive him means to receive grace upon grace. I wish it said it more. I wish it said grace upon grace upon grace upon grace. That should be a new song. One of y'all should write it. Grace upon grace. That could be the whole chorus. And if it was a Hillsong song, they'd sing it for 30 minutes. And it would be just as powerful at the end. Folks, the message of the book of John is the gospel, the truth of who Jesus is. He's lived forever and ever. He's going to live forever and ever. That's why heaping all of the sin and the penalty of death on him wasn't anything for him to lose, because he's already going to live what? Forever and ever. Why? He spoke life into existence. He doesn't need any help. He doesn't need any help from you. He just wants you to know who he is. But here's the cool thing. He already knows you. How awesome would it be if I walked up to Taylor Swift and handed her a guitar and asked her to sign it, and she looked at me and said, Mike Mitchell, I've been waiting to meet you. At that point, I would be a super fan. You can't shake that off. She knew me. Folks, when I got to Jesus, he already knew me. He knew everything I'd done, and he loved me anyway. To receive him is to receive that grace upon grace upon grace forever. I hope that you will do that this morning. It says this, when we did baptism, it says, remember your baptism. Remember that you once was a wretch, and now you are clean. Oh, to remember, Lord, to help me to abide in the joy of my own salvation. And if this morning you've never received Him as Lord, please don't walk out. Don't walk out of here that way. Ain't no real chance. I'm not a scare tactic kind of guy, but there ain't no real surety you're going to walk back in next week. Don't walk away from Him today. 2 weeks from now, we're going to do baptism again. I'm getting wet that day. Yeah. I'm not wearing waders either. I'm going in with you. Hey, 2 weeks, you can get saved. We can go meet and visit, and you can get baptized 2 weeks too. It's coming. I hope that you will respond to the Word of God this morning. Please stand. We sang a song this morning, Victory in Jesus. My brother asked me, he said, man, can we sing that every time we have baptism? I'm thinking that's not a bad idea at all, to sing Victory in Jesus. But here's the thing, Victory in Jesus is only a really, really amazing song if you're living in the victory of Jesus. So please, this morning, live in His victory.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily live. I surrender. Savior, I surrender all.
Can I throw a curveball this morning? Can we leave in victory in Jesus this morning? I just think it's a good one. You go out this week, even when it gets dark outside, and you praise God, you shine your light so bright that the people around you see Jesus. And if I could, Brother Zane, and I do say brother, I know you're hiding back there somewhere. Could you come down here with me? You got to get down here before they get out in the aisles. They get out in the aisles, they get to talking. You can't get down that aisle.
Not.
You have plenty. If there are some family to come up, Zane's a real shy guy. If you want to come and stand with him, he's a very shy fellow. If I can have a couple of family members. Anybody, a family member? Brother, would you please come sit? They're like, no, I'm not standing with him. Come on, somebody come stand with Zane. I would say, I'm going to stand with you, brother. There they go. Man, you get one of them on each side of you. You got something. Goodness gracious. Now you come stand on this side. Goodness. Ain't nobody messing with Zane this morning. Come on. Lead us off, brother.
All right.
Victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. I loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing.